That was the air squadron in St Andrews. So I've got everybody named there. That's Andrew Chalmers there. And I'm beside Andrew Chalmers, that's me. But he learned his flying in Canada. So we had 3 months in a residence. We had to sew in all our buttons.
I did some initial flying at Lookers while I was in St Andrews. And then I was posted straight to London. Then I actually came back to Dumfries and did a lot of navigational training, and then started training laterally on Lancasters. So I was crewed up with Peter Weeks as the pilot. And then after that, I trained to be a navigator, which meant I was actually sent to Eastbourne to do initial training.
And part of the training was actually taking photographs. When you flew over a target and dropped your bombs, you always took a photograph. But in Lancaster, it was done automatically. That, you know, when you pressed the button over the target area, it actually took photographs after that so that you could see where the bombs had dropped. You can see the aircraft all round about, presumably at Dumfries. And obviously just 2 runways. These look like army vehicles in a field, so presumably they've got extra marks for detecting them. An interesting exercise. I mean, it gave you a nice change from just navigating.
Was a logbook just given to navigators?
No.
Everyone had a log.
Everybody had a logbook. If you were flying at all,
right,
where you logged all your flights, right from training.
So we did our first flight in the Lancaster on the April the 24th, and that was in 1943. That was a reception area in London, and we used to get paid in Lords when we were there. So I'm right at the front holding the number of the photograph.
That was how I became a navigator instead of a pilot.
Oh, right.
Yeah. There was somebody next door in the next Nissen hut who said he was cleaning his gun. I was just sitting up in bed, and there was something hit me here. In fact, I still have the mark. And looked down, and here was a bullet.
So they obviously went bulletproof.
That is fairly obvious. So I was carted off to hospital, and etc. And all the rest of the people that were there with me all left Anstey, you know, to go to other flying schools, and I was left behind. And of course in the RAF, if you're an odd man out and you don't have anywhere to go, that is a major problem. So I was in the hospital, and then they sort of just start the operation of just sending you to, I think I was sent to Manchester, you know, for no other reason than to make somebody else decide where I should go. 12 Squadron was based at Wickenby in Lincoln.
Now that was one taken in Wickenby in front of a Lancaster. Now don't ask me where I am there.
What was a tour of operations?
It meant 30 nights, 1 or 2 weeks. You see, when it was full moon, we didn't fly at all because we were just sitting targets for the German fighter. So we only went on the really dark nights. On a normal mission that takes sights of the Polestar,
So pathfinders dropped markers which helped you to find your way across Germany. When you got near the target, you actually bombed markers. Our first flights were over the Ruhr to Düsseldorf, Essen, Wuppertal, back to Düsseldorf, Mulheim, Gelsenkirchen. At the end of June we went to Cologne. Then we had a long flight to Turin, which took nearly 9.5 hours, and we couldn't quite get back all the way to Lincolnshire, so we landed at Chivenor, near Plymouth. And then we moved on to a Mark III Lancaster, which was a much better aircraft, and we did operations to Hamburg, Genoa, Nuremberg, Milan, and Peenemünde was the one where they were developing the V-1 and the V-2 bombs to attack London. And we were told that we had to destroy the base at Peenemünde, or we would go back every night until it was. Unfortunately, they were able to continue to produce the V-1 and the V-2 bombs, which they launched against London. And when we were flying later in 1943, we used to see these V1 and V2 bombs be launched.
We had a rear gunner and a mid-upper gunner, a bombing pilot, navigator, and a radio operator.
One of the most important members was the flight engineer, and that was a lad called Frank Rickling, and he had been a ground engineer on aircraft, and he knew Lancasters and other aircraft intimately. And when we had the accident when another aircraft above us and bombed us, the engine was on fire, boom, he put the fire out immediately. And I think you know, if you'd been a couple of minutes later, you know, hadn't reacted immediately, it would have been
disaster.
In the morning, when your aircraft was being serviced, I mean, he was out helping the men to service and make sure the job was a first-class job. So that he was magnificent. I have a feeling that what happened, it was accidentally over the target area that an aircraft flew across us, above us fortunately, and dropped a few small bombs on us, which actually shattered the canopy above me. I can always remember I grabbed my navigation plot and all the paperwork, so I didn't lose that, and I was able to pin that down, you know, on my desk. But the canopy above me and the pilot and the bomb aimer was knocked off. When we landed, the boss, that's the front part of one of the engines, it actually flew off. Fortunately, it didn't hit anybody on the runway. But the one person we met there, you have heard this before.
No, never.
You haven't. It was Rex Harrison. So he was very amused the next day when I asked him for his autograph.